Hello, everyone. This is Heather Moorfield Lang from the University of South Carolina. I'm going to be talking to you today about Librarian as Innovator for the AASL Fall Forum for 2014. I'm going to be speaking to you today about 15 websites in 15 minutes, and this is specifically coming from my role as the chair for the AASL Best Websites for Teaching and Learning. So that's 15 websites in 15 minutes, so that doesn't give me a whole lot of time. But I've tried to choose 15 sites that kind of embrace the idea of a librarian as an innovator in the library space, in the school, with students, with teachers, with administrators, whatever the case may be. So I hope you like these. If you have any questions, I have my contact information at the end of this presentation. And technically, I have 14 websites and one that I've kind of cheated on. So my first site I'm going to share with you today is indeed the AASL Best Websites for Teaching and Learning site. This is where we have all 150 sites that have won at this time for the American Association of School Librarians Best Websites for Teaching and Learning. This site also has resources, all of our presentations over the last 6 years. It has multiple pieces of information, all of our bookmarks, all of our resources, our Pinterest boards, all different types of information that you can use in your libraries, professional development with your teachers, all different types of things that you can take and use in the spirit of innovation in your schools. So the first site that I'd like to talk to you about that's really more of just a site is ThingLink. Now, I'm not sure if you've used ThingLink before, but ThingLink is one of my favorite websites. And ThingLink allows you to put a layer of augmented reality, or reality, if you will, into an image. It is both a website and it is an app. And this particular site allows you to embed information into pictures. And this is a picture of me at the beginning of Route 66 in Chicago with my Route 66 shirt on. And you can see behind me, I've got an image of Chicago. It's me right there on the street. And the dots, the bullseyes that you see in the image are actual pieces of information that when you click on them or link on them, you get information. One of those is a time-lapsed video of the entire Route 66. One of them is about the Mother Road. I think one of them is about Chicago. So there's all different types of information. And you can embed anything that you like into a ThingLink picture. And so you can embed videos, you can embed documents, you can embed pictures, you can embed websites, anything that is embeddable or linkable, you can put and make an image come to life. And that's the entire idea behind ThingLink. One of my favorite sites. Hope you enjoy it as well. Haiku Deck. Haiku Deck, well, it is a presentation site, and at this moment in time, well, you're looking at it. It is a presentation tool that allows you to create slides. It works with the Getty Museum to increase their amount of images by up to 1 million. And we have Creative Commons licenses, and it allows you to download your presentation in a PDF or PowerPoint format completely for free. And then once you have downloaded, all of the Creative Commons attributions are already linked to the images that you have embedded into your presentation. Really like ThingLink, very easy, very user intuitive, and is a lot of fun to use as a presentation tool. The next tool I want to tell you about is Miograph. Miograph is described as four-dimensional storytelling. And the reason why it's four-dimensional is because you have a timeline, you have mapping, you have videos, and you also have narration. So it starts with a map. You decide on your map what you'd like to embed in a map, similar to ThingLink. You can embed images, pictures, information. You build a timeline, and the timeline is if you'd like to do a historical information about a map. You can link the dates of how things have happened. You can put the mapping in there, and then you can show us everything that has happened on the map date-wise, and it will take us through. So we can have images, we can have pictures, we can have documents, we can have videos, and then we can put on a layer of narration that can take us through the timeline, what is happening, information, and all of those types of things. Really good for oral narrations, if we're looking for oral histories, if we're looking for historical context. Very interesting site, and really kind of taking that digital storytelling, digital narration to that next level. A really fun site and a lot of interesting ideas that you can take with this and where you can go with this. History Pin, kind of along the lines of Miograph, but History Pin has really grown over the past 2 years since it was awarded Best Websites. And the way History Pin works is it is a digital curation of images across the world. And what they are looking to do is to create a digital historical archive of information and images all across the world. And what you can do is you find a spot on the map, you upload images, and the collection of images is now over 1 million. And so you can actually search by location and find images. So if we wanted to search for a location in North Carolina, if we wanted to search for a location in England, we could search for a location any place that we wish. And then you can actually see what the place looks like now. You can see what it looked like then. You can see the historical images. And if you were looking to do a digital narrative, if you were looking, again, to do a historical piece or historical oral history, you can do all different types of things. And you can do that through HistoryPen and do a digital narrative archival project with this particular tool. Lots of fun. And to be quite honest, it's just really enjoyable just to search through all the images and to see where this is going with this particular project. And while this image says that it is in beta, it is actually not in beta anymore, but I really liked this image a great deal, and that's the reason why I wanted to include it. So Gibbon, if you haven't used Gibbon yet, I highly recommend giving it a try. For those of you who like playlists like Spotify or Pandora, Gibbon is the same idea. Gibbon allows us as librarians or students or teachers to create playlists for learning. Think of it like a bookmarking tool if you wish, but if you like to make lists and to share those lists, Gibbon lets us create lists for learning, and then we can finish them off like books, put book covers on them, and then share them. We can make them public, or on Gibbon you can go pro and you can make them private and share them only with your students, only with your teachers for professional development, only for your peer librarians. You can do whatever you would like. It's completely up to you. And so if I wanted to make a playlist for makerspaces, I can create a list of websites. I can create a list of libraries and locations where makerspaces are already there. I could create a list for information commons, for digital archiving, whatever the case may be. I can create a digital Gibbon list, a playlist, if you will, for whatever that I want. And then I can release that. And what happens is they call them a class. And then anyone who wants to join your class and find out your information can learn from your playlist. A lot of fun, easy to share, and easy to learn. Pearl Trees. For those of you who may have started with Pearl Trees a few years back, Pearl Trees started out as a social media tool. I like a certain topic, someone else likes a certain topic, together we can meet and we can talk about that particular topic through social media. But Pearl Trees has kind of changed its focus. Now it's a little more digital curation based. In other words, if I want to collect a particular amount of tools about digital storytelling, I can gather all of my pearls together and gather them up in what they call pearl trees. And it is a tree with all different types of leaves or pearls in the tree. And then now, if you haven't looked at Pearl Trees lately, it actually has a very Pinterest look to it, because once you click on any of your pearls or your sections of a pearl tree, it actually opens up into a Pinterest board. So if I was collecting digital storytelling for elementary age students, I can gather sites, I can gather stories, I can gather information, I can put them all together in a pearl tree. And then when it is released and I collect everything and folks are looking at my pearl tree, when they click on the information, though it looks like circles when I click on it, everything opens up, as you can see right here, into squares. And it's a much more seamless, more kind of interesting to look at, Pinterest style board to look at the information that is in Pearl Trees. So digital curation tool, bookmarking tool, if you are looking at that as a way to innovate ways to collect and curate for your students, teachers, administrators, and community. Figment. If you haven't had a chance to try out Figment, I definitely recommend it. This is a newer tool. Figment is for those folks who are looking at reading and writing and doing it with a community. So this is a chance to really get involved with a writing community. And this is a great chance for our young readers, our young writers, our adolescent readers and writers to get involved with communities. And then as they write, they can share, they can get feedback, and then they can also read about other people's work that they have done, and they can share those amongst themselves. It is a reading community. If you like things such as Goodreads, along those lines, you have those abilities to share the different things that you've read, give criticisms, give critiques, give information and recommendations But on the flip side, this is also a writing community where you can also share your writing and get feedback everywhere from sonnets and mysteries to, you know, quick novels. You can do anything you want here. A lot of fun, and I actually know quite a few librarians who have been involved with this particular tool. Along with that, just to kind of go hand in hand, we have Biblionasium, which is another reading community where you can share your favorite things, you can share your favorite books, you can share your favorite information. They also have digital badges, and our committee member for AASL Best Websites, Shannon Miller, is actually involved with the executive board. This past year has become involved with Biblionasium, and it's a lot of fun, a lot of ways to get involved with the reading community. So you've got Figment, and I would recommend that for a little bit older group of students. Then you have Biblionasium, which I would recommend maybe for a little bit younger. And so it's a new reading community for your younger folks, and just a way to really get your students involved online with that type of reading community. International Children's Digital Library has been around for quite a while. It was actually, for AASL Best Websites, one of our very first winners. And folks may go, okay, well, this is a little old. But you know what? I feel that this is one of the most innovative tools that has actually come out. And while it has not changed a great deal over the last few years, I still feel that this is one of the cleanest, neatest, most awesome tools that is available. It is also an app that is available for your iPad and your iPhone, and it is still one of the neatest apps that is out there. This particular tool, ICDL, allows us to have over 2,000 books in different languages from different countries available to us for our libraries, for our students, all available online. They're available in different languages. And the one really great thing about ICDL was they actually had a group of children on their planning committee to decide how their website would be run, how their website would be designed, and how visitors would be able to choose books, whether it be by color, by title, by size, by design, and it is just one of the most user-friendly, intuitive, and when it comes to really innovative ways to get books out to kids, I really still think that ICDL is just a wonderful, beautiful website. And even though it's been around for a while, I still think that this is just a fantastic site and highly, highly recommend it. If by some chance you don't know about it, and even if you did, maybe you've forgotten about it. So I still really recommend it, because when it comes to innovation, they really, really stepped out for this one. It runs itself these days. It's really doing a nice job. Along the lines of digital storytelling is Inanimate Alice. And for those of you who like graphic novels, Inanimate Alice has been around for about 4 years, continuously changing and growing. Right now they have 4 chapters in the Inanimate Alice world, but this is a digital interactive graphic novel. Soon chapter 5 will be coming. They work with Edmodo. They work with Smartboard. They work with Promethean. They have lesson plans for those of us in the classrooms to be able to integrate into our classrooms. They have digital storytelling lessons. They have different languages. You can read about Alice in 5 or 6 different languages, all different types of stuff, and they are continuing to work and grow and figure out new ways that they can be available for us. Continuously looking for new ways to work for librarians, for teachers in the schools, and just a really innovative way to get digital graphic novels, information, reading, and literacy out to the students. Some of the next tools that I'm going to show you are more some of our handheld device, though these are website, student response systems. The next two do very much the same thing. The first one is Kahoot, and the second one is Socrative. For those of you who may have been aware of sites like Poll Everywhere or Answer Garden, where you can get in-the-moment polling, these two sites, Kahoot and Socrative, do similar things, but they're a little bit more game-based response classrooms and response systems. What you can do with these is you can actually create multiple choice, true, false, short answer. Students can fill out questions by their computers. These are both device agnostic, which means you can use them with your smartphones, you can use them with your laptop, you can use them with your iPads, with any sort of tablet. It does not matter what type of device you have, as long as it can get onto the internet, they can access these particular tools. And so instead of just having a poll, you now can do all sorts of questions. They record your data. They give you feedback. They give you reports. They give you tickets. They do all sorts of things. And so they're taking that level of polling and they're going even further. And so these response systems really take us further into the classrooms of being able to get those students even further involved who might be a little bit shy at speaking out in class, taking that technology even further for our students, really making things exciting and interesting and further along those lines in the classroom. If you haven't visited Wonderopolis, Wonderopolis is just a wonderful site. I'm using the word wonder a lot because this is the site where students can just figure out how things work and they can wonder why things are the way they are. If you want to know why people sweat, if you want to know why clouds are white and why the sky is blue, they can figure it all out at Wonderopolis. And every single day there is a new wonder. So every day you can start your class out with a new wonder. If you're a librarian who has a student news program, you can start the news out with a new wonder. You can follow them on Twitter and do the wonders from there. Wonderopolis is a great tool that just shares and has a true heart for the love of learning. And these are folks who just really want to be out there and help us with our teaching and our instruction of our students. We have at this time awarded one coding site, but coding and programming is an area that I know for us as librarians, as innovators, that we are going to have to continue to keep up with. I'm not saying everyone needs to run out and take Java and programming and scripting classes, but being aware of coding, being aware of programming, being aware of things like Code Academy, Code Monkey, and other types of coding sites. But one of our winners was Code Academy, and this is a great site. It takes you through coding and the basics, along with digital badges as each student makes their way through, teaching students how to code and work with websites and browsers. And so this was one of our winners, and I did want to bring that to everyone's attention because as we move into those levels and skills, this can be a very useful site for that. So I'm really excited to see what the future does hold for us. It can be really exciting. We typically on the AASL Best Websites review about 100 sites. We've already started for 2015 ALA San Francisco. We've got about 50 sites already. We hope to have about another 50, if not more. If you'd like to nominate any sites, we recommend that you do so. Please send us nominations. We love new nominations. So this is my contact information. Please feel free to contact me via email, Twitter, my website. Thanks so much for letting me share some sites with you today. Love sharing new sites, new technology, and information with everyone. Thanks so much. Hope you have a great rest of your AASL forum.